January 2008, and we're getting ready to cruise around the southern half of South America. Let's take a look at where we're going.
Our trip will start out with a really long plane ride as we leave Minneapolis and fly to Buenos Aires, Argentina, a flight of around 7,500 miles. In Buenos Aires, we will board our ship, the Norwegian Dream. From Buenos Aires, we will sail overnight to Montevideo, Uruguay. From Montevideo, we'll sail down the Atlantic Ocean to Puerto Madryn, Argentina. From here, we head out to sea as we proceed to our next stop, the town of Stanley in the Falkland Islands. We will then head to the most southern point of South America as we sail around Cape Horn. After sailing around the Cape, we proceed to Ushuaia, Argentina. After leaving Ushuaia, we'll be sailing through the Beagle Channel. We'll keep sailing through the maze of channels and islands until we reach Punta Arenas, Chile. After leaving Punta Arenas, we'll sail the Strait of Magellan, then into the Chilean fjords until we reach Puerto Chacabuco, Chile. From Chacabuco, we'll sail up the coast to Portomont, Chile. Our final stop is Valparaiso, Chile, where we'll leave the ship and travel by land to Santiago, where we'll catch a flight back to Minneapolis.
So we've got a lot of new and exciting places to go and lots of new things to see and experience, such as Pisco Sours, Guanacos, Gauchos, Wasus, Penguins, and who knows what else. So we're really anxious to be off.
Don't cry for me, Argentina. The truth is, I never left you. All through my wild.
After over 20 hours of traveling, we finally arrive in Buenos Aires. We're tired, but really happy to be here. We're bussed out to our ship, and the long flight is quickly forgotten as we relax over cocktails and watch from the sports bar as the ship gets slowly underway.
I never invited them in, though it seemed to the world they were all I desired. They are illusions. They're not the solutions they promised to me.
In Montevideo, we take our first tour. We are on the trail of the Graf Spee, a World War II German warship that was damaged by three smaller British ships and put into the Montevideo harbor, which was a neutral country, for repairs. These are photos of the Graf Spee. The last two photos show her sitting in the Montevideo harbor waiting to be repaired. The hill in the background of the ship is where we are headed to get an overview of the harbor and the surrounding area. There was a lot of negotiation between the British, the Germans, and the local officials over how long the ship could stay in this neutral harbor. Finally, it was decided that they would have to leave within 3 days. The motor coach has taken us up the hill, and we get a nice view of the harbor and the surrounding area. The Germans buried 18 of their men in Montevideo, so we visit the cemetery where they're buried. One British soldier was also buried in the British cemetery on Montevideo. Our tour finally ends with a visit to a museum that has many of the artifacts from the Graf Spee, as well as many other items of interest. What finally happened to the Graf Spee? The British had spread a rumor that several of their other ships had come to help blockade the harbor to prevent an escape. The Germans, fearing this, sailed the ship out of the harbor on the third day and scuttled it a few miles from Montevideo. This morning we arrive in Puerto Madryn, Argentina. The town was founded by Welsh settlers in the late 1800s. It's a tourist town known for its beaches and its wildlife sanctuary on Peninsula Valdez, which has a colony of around 1 million penguins. This is part of Patagonia, which is a geographical area that covers most of the southern part of South America. Here at Puerto Madryn, the land is arid and without much vegetation. There's a steppe or a hill right behind the town, and once over this rise, it is very desolate. We elect not to take the 5-hour tour to the penguins, and instead take a tour to Trelew, to a dinosaur museum. Jeanette and I aren't really that interested in dinosaurs, but there weren't any other good options other than the 5-hour bumpy, dusty ride out to the penguins. But it's still interesting to see the various displays. From here, we will go to another small Welsh village where we will have tea and cookies and be entertained by one of their local choirs. It is really interesting to be this far from home and hear the same hymns being sung that we sing at home, especially those that they sing in their native language. After lunch, we head back to Puerto Madryn, and along the way we stop at a colony of sea lions. There must be hundreds of them down in this little cove along the ocean. Harold and Jeanette, I'm sure, don't see eye to eye here. I'm sure Jeanette is thinking that it would really be nice to get down on the beach and get a much closer look. Harold, on the other hand, I'm sure is thinking that from the smell of things, there isn't any way he's walking this beach. Finally, we leave the sea lions and head back to the ship and get ready to sail to our next port of call, the Falkland Islands. Sailor's warning indeed. As we head out to sea and albatross trails our ship, surely this is a sign of good fortune to come. It isn't long, however, before the winds begin to pick up. We start getting waves in the 10 to 15 foot range, and the ship has to slow down. This means we'll be late getting to the Falkland Islands, and we have to tender in there as they don't have a dock. And with waves this high, that won't be possible. The wind and the waves continue to build until they eventually reach gale force 11, and the captain makes the decision to turn around and head out of the storm. So it's so long, Falklands. We'll have to catch you next time around. Overnight, we have sailed out of the storm. However, we are heading to Cape Horn, which is also located in the furious 50s and is famous for having high winds and waves because there isn't any landmass in the Southern Ocean to interrupt them. Waves of 20 to 30 feet are common, as are rogue waves, which have been reported to reach as high as 100 feet. We reached the Cape early in the morning, and the weather is overcast, but there's virtually no wind and very small waves. Really unusual for this area. The cape itself is just a small island, or really huge rock just jutting out of the ocean, with lots of similar islands or rocks close by. We circle the island and get a close-up view from all sides before heading into one of the channels leading to our next stop. We receive a certificate from the captain acknowledging that we have followed the routes of the ancient mariners and navigated around Cape Horn. When we rounded Cape Horn, we were near the bottom of the Earth, as we were within 700 miles of Antarctica. As we sail away from Cape Horn, we enter into one of the main channels in this maze of rocks and islands. Because of the high winds, waves, and even icebergs, this area is known as the Sailor's Graveyard. The early sailors had their choice of going around the Cape and risking the dangers of the open ocean, or taking one of several narrower channels and risk being driven into the rocks. Either choice had a high degree of risk. The opening of the Panama Canal greatly reduced the trade shipping that used these most southerly routes. We keep proceeding through the channels towards our next port of call. We arrive in Ushuaia early due to skipping past the Falklands. Ushuaia is truly the end of the world. It is the southernmost city in the world. It is a small, beautiful town sitting right on the edge of the ocean with the snow-capped Andes Mountains in the background. Ushuaia is truly a beautiful but terribly remote spot of the world. Because we got in early, Jeanette and I decided to take an evening tour, while Harold and Elaine decided to investigate the town. Our tour takes us up to the prison, which has now been turned into a museum. It has a lot of artifacts from the area and is also used to display a lot of the local handicrafts from this area. The town was started when the Argentine government sent 20 prisoners down here to build a prison. The prisoners were treated very strictly and were used to build a prison and to provide for all the necessities of life for everyone in the area. This practice continued as more and more people moved into the area. Without the prisoners providing for the necessities of life, this area may not have ever been settled. As we leave the prison / museum, we head up into the mountains and stop in a beautiful valley to take some photos. We are told that all the valley bottoms in this area are peat bogs. We leave the valley and we drive further into the mountains, and we stop at an overlook where we get a nice view of a lake. Then it's back on the bus as we drive down to a small lodge that's located on the lake shore. It's really a scenic area, and while we are here, a rain shower passes through and we are treated to two rainbows. It's now nearly 11 o'clock in the evening, and it's still light. We head back to town and stop along the way in a really beautiful valley for dinner. By the time we're finished with dinner and get back to our ship, it's nearly 1 o'clock in the morning, and we have another trip starting at 7 a.m. This is getting to be hard work. This morning we are up early and off on another tour. Today we are going to the Terra del Fuego National Park. Our first stop is at the Beagle Channel, a very scenic spot. Oh no, don't tell me these are our traveling companions. Before heading back to the ship, we make a couple more stops in the park to get out and investigate and take some more photos. This is really a beautiful area, and it would really be nice to have more time to spend here. But our ship is sailing shortly after lunch, so we can only spend about 4 hours in the park, and then it's time to head back to the ship. As we sail away from Ushuaia, we get a really fantastic view of the mountains towering over this little community. What a beautiful place. This afternoon, we are sailing through the Beagle Channel, heading towards Punta Arenas. So with nothing else to do, we relax in one of the lounges and watch the beautiful scenery go by. And every so often, we take a couple of pictures through the windows. Let's hope NCL did a good job of keeping the windows clean. The Beagle Channel separates several islands from Tierra del Fuego, the name given to the southernmost portion of Argentina, where we have just come from. The channel is about 150 miles long and anywhere from 3 to 8 miles wide, although from our vantage point, it looks a lot narrower. It is navigable by large ships such as ours, but the Drake Passage and the Strait of Magellan are much safer. The channel was named after the British ship HMS Beagle, commanded by Captain Robert Fitzroy. It was on this voyage that a young man by the name of Charles Darwin came along as an amateur naturalist. We are now in glacier country, and they are stunning. They look small to the naked eye because of the height of the mountains and the fact that most of them are hanging glaciers and do not come down to the sea. But as we zoom in on them, it is obvious that there is a lot of snow and ice up there.
Thank you.
The last glacier that we come across is the most impressive. It has a huge river of water gushing out of it, flowing down the side of the mountain into the sea. What a fantastic sight. Night is creeping up on us, and in the morning we should be at our next port of call. It's been a really great day. This morning, Jeanette and I are on an all-day tour to a sheep ranch. It starts out with a nice overview of Punta Arenas. Harold and Elaine have opted for an easier half-day tour, but it actually turns out to be a really tough, wet, and muddy trek up and down a mountain. But good troopers that they are, they survive to laugh about it. We are driving out onto the Patagonian steppe in order to get out to the ranch. Along the way, we see several rheas. They're big, ostrich-like birds that seem to be roaming all over the place. We also come across several guanacos standing near the top of a hill. I also get a photo of two condors flying high overhead. Before we get to the ranch that we're going to, we run across a very large herd of sheep. The ranch is located on an island separated from the mainland by an arm of the Beagle Channel. The island is 50 miles wide and 80 miles long and has 12 ranches on it. Before we can get there, we have to figure out a way to get across this channel. And here's how we're doing it. Bus is going on this homemade ferry to get us across to the other side. At first glance, this ranch looks more like a junkyard than anything else, but this guy is a collector, and I doubt whether he's ever thrown anything at all away. But the offset to that is he has flowers and gardens planted all over the place. And the flowers are just huge. It looks like they're on steroids, and they're gorgeous. Thank you. The ranch sits on a small hillside alongside an arm of the Beagle Channel. It's kind of a pretty setting, but it's a little bit barren without any trees. The first order of business is to head towards the barn, and as we do so, we run into a small group of their alpacas. In the barn, we get a chance to look over all of his collectibles, and he has a pile full. And then it's on to a sheep shearing demonstration. Wow, that's some haircut. This guy needs to go to the barber a little bit more often. Hey, how about that? Anybody need a wool coat? Other than that little white guy laying there? He also does a quick demonstration on milking a cow and gives some of the city suckers a taste.
Don't want to swim. They say it's a little bit cold today. It's chilly. It's chilly.
This is a church that they built by hand out of logs that they harvested on their own property. Then it's back to the guest house for pisco sours and empanadas. Then they pull the lamb off the barbecue and cut it up, and it's time for lunch. After lunch, they do a demonstration on sheep herding.
Thank you.
While we're waiting for the bus, Jeanette gets a wagon ride around the farmstead. And from the look on her face as she gets off the wagon, it looks like she really enjoyed it. Then it's back on the motor coach as we say farewell to Estancia Fitzroy and head back to the ship. This has been a really, really great day. Today we leave Punta Arenas and are cruising up the Strait of Magellan. The strait is about 350 miles long and anywhere from 2 to 20 miles wide. Before the opening of the Panama Canal, this was the most popular trade route for ships moving from the Atlantic to the Pacific, or vice versa. It is very overcast and hazy out today with intermittent periods of drizzle. We're sailing past some beautiful scenery. However, with the haze and the overcast, there isn't much color today. So it's another day of relaxing and lounging around on the ship and shooting some occasional photos. Late in the afternoon, we come upon the Amalia Glacier, a fairly large glacier flowing down to the sea. This is just one of 48 glaciers that come out of the southern ice fields. The southern ice field makes up the third largest continental ice shelf in the world, with only Antarctica and Iceland being larger. This ice field is considered to hold one-third of the world's reserve of fresh water. After leaving the glacier, we continue cruising through the night. Today we will be cruising all day as we head towards Chacabuco. We are in the Chilean fjords, and we'll also be going through the Patagonic Channel and the Canal Meralda. We really can't tell where we are, as this area of the world is just a maze of islands and channels. And because of the Andes Mountains so close to the ocean, it is almost always hazy and overcast in this region, so we can't see just too far off the ship. A sunny day in this area is a real rarity. We don't have much color again today, as the day is very gray and hazy, but as we sail further and further north, the weather is beginning to become warmer. While we spend our day cruising, we have time to walk around the ship, maybe take in one of the lectures that are frequently held in the auditorium, or just relax and visit. We had plenty of time to have a leisurely lunch and relax with a good book and still take some photos every now and then. Then time for a cocktail late in the afternoon before heading to the show in the Stardust Lounge, and then a great dinner to top off the day. What a great way to travel. Chacabuco early in the morning, just as we are getting up. What a beautiful place. The Andes Mountains surround this little harbor, and it's as if the mountains literally fall into the sea. The town consists of one restaurant, a fish processing plant, and the port. This port serves a very isolated portion of the country that contains only 0.5% of Chile's total population. But oh, what a beautiful spot it is. There aren't any docks here, so we have to tender into shore. Today we are on a tour to Aiken del Sur Park. It's in a pretty valley with mountains on two sides and a lake at the end of the valley. A tour guide takes us on a hike and tells us about the various plants and wildlife in the area. There's a little stream flowing through this area, and at the end of the hike, we come upon a fairly impressive waterfall called Old Man Beard's Waterfall. After the hike, they take us up to a shelter on a hill that overlooks the lake. There we are welcomed with the official drink, Pisco Sours, and some of their local wines. And we're served a couple of different types of empanadas. They also entertain us with some of their local musicians and dancers. Time to get back on board the ship. The sky keeps continuing to clear, so before we sail, we get another really good view of Chacabuco and the surrounding area. Scenery as we sail away from Chacabuco is really great, made more so by the fact that we finally have some sunshine. Late in the afternoon, the crew, which is made up of people from 30 to 40 different countries, put on an entertainment show for us in Stardust Lounge. It's not overly professional, but it's really entertaining. This has really been another great day. Oh. This morning we are in Puertollano, Chile, a town of about 85,000 people and capital of one of Chile's provinces. Its principal industries are forestry and fishing. There are over 30 salmon farms in the area. We are on a tour to a horse ranch this morning, and our first stop is on a hill overlooking the town, where we get a nice overview of Puertollano and our ship sitting in the harbor. On the way out to the farm, we make a couple of stops along the way. In Puerto Varas, the gals get a shopping stop and pick up a few things, while Harold and I find a restaurant and get a cup of coffee and a pastry. I also find a local musician playing in the park and pick up a CD for background music for this video. Then it's back on the motor coach as we drive out to Fundo Oquita, a ranch that raises purebred Chilean horses. We are greeted by the local Wasis, Chile's version of a cowboy. We are escorted down to the barn, where we are seated on bales of hay and served pisco sours and empanadas. They have some musicians and dancers there ready to entertain us.
We have Luis right here.
Here
we have Leo.
They give us a quick explanation of the Wasu's outfit and introduce the owner of the ranch, Senior Nelson Garcia. And then it's time to go to the rodeo. On the way to the rodeo, we take a detour through one of the barns to view their horses. Their horses are a little bit on the small side, but they're known for their endurance and stamina and their ability to withstand the harsh weather that they have here on the Patagonian plains. They are supposed to be some pretty tough little horses. We also walk past Senior Garcia's home, which is quite impressive, including the front door to his house. Then it's time for the rodeo, which is quite a bit different from our rodeos at home. And they give us demonstrations of some of the things that they have to perform. One of the things that they must do is they have to teach their horse to be able to run sideways. They must also be able to ride a figure eight in both directions, keeping the same line. The reason their horse needs to run sideways is apparent in this event. One rider chases the steer forward while the other rider rides on the side of the steer, pushing the steer up against the fence with his horse. The final event that they demonstrate is barrel racing. While this is all going on, we're having a good time watching the show, watching the birds, drinking more pisco sours, more Chilean wine, and eating more empanadas. After the rodeo, we are invited inside, and we have a very enjoyable lunch. Then after lunch, we are given time and we are able to lounge around outside and view the beautiful scenery and look at some of the plants and flowers that they have planted around the yard. Then it's time to head back to Portomont and the Norwegian Dream with one quick photo stop along the way. It's been another really good day. After leaving Portomont, we spend the next day out at sea. Not too much to see today as we are out several miles from shore. So it's a day of rest and relaxation. This morning, we arrived in Valparaiso, our final leg of the cruise. We have a tour planned for today which will take us over to Santiago, and then we will board our plane around 10:30 this evening and fly back home. Our tour quickly takes us out of Valparaiso and into the wine country. We stop at one of the many wineries for a tour of their facilities. We spend a little time checking out the reception area, and then we go into the processing plant to see how they process the grapes and turn them into wine. Then it's back to the reception area to taste both their red and their white wines, neither of which we thought were overly good. We have some free time before it's time to get back on the motor coach. So we go outside and we get a nice overview of the area, as well as getting a chance to check out some of their nearby vineyards, and we also get a chance to check out some of their flower gardens. Then it's time to head on down the road. This has been kind of an interesting stop. Our next stop is at another horse ranch, where we are greeted as we drive in by this little gal on horseback. We are served the official drink, pisco sours, some of their local Chilean wines, and empanadas. While they do a demonstration and give us some information on their horses and the costumes that the Wasus are wearing. Then we go down to the arena where they demonstrate some of the skills of these Chilean horses and the Wasu riders. Some of those skills are making the horse run sideways without running into anybody, and also going full blast and putting on the brakes and making the horse stand on its tail. Probably a lot harder than it looks. Then it's off to the traditional things, like the Chilean dance and the showing of the horses. Being that we're now experienced in this area, and the fact that it's really quite warm, we decide to sit this one out in the shade and wait for lunch. After lunch, it's back on the motor coach as we head towards Santiago. It's a long drive through some hilly countryside. Santiago is a huge city of 6 million people. As we drive through the city, we see some of the old parts of town, and then they take us to their government center, and we get out and tour the government center. Not overly impressive, but it kills some time, as we have plenty of time before our plane leaves. Our next stop is to a park where there's a funicular that's going to take us up a fairly large hill so that we can get an overview of Santiago. There's a huge crowd here and it takes a long time to get onto the funicular. From the top of the hill, we get a great overview of the city of Santiago. We also get a good look at the statue that's perched on top of the hill. Time is running short, so it's time to go back down the hill and head off for the airport. At the airport, we have time for a quick snack, and then it's onto the plane, and we're headed back home. It's truly been a great trip.
truth is, I never left you. All through my wild days, my mad excuse.
Our journey to the end of the world is over, and what a trip it was. We traveled nearly 25,000 miles, enough to almost circle the earth. We traveled with 1,700 other people, of which only 500 were from the United States. The rest of the people were divided among 30 other countries. So you can imagine the number of different languages we heard spoken on this trip. We really enjoyed traveling with Harold and Elaine. They made for really good traveling companions. The food on the trip was excellent, and the things that we saw and the things we experienced we'll remember for a long, long time to come. For example, we'll never forget Ushuaia, one of the most beautiful places we've seen. Don't cry for me, Argentina. Or this place, Chacabuco, another great setting. And how could we forget the glaciers as we came through the Beagle Channel? Or who could ever forget this guy? Poor little guy. He's got itches, and he can only reach a couple places with those flippers. Don't cry for Let's hope he got his itch taken care of. Yes, we have lots of really good things to remember from this trip. And traveling with good friends tops the list. Cruising South America has been really great, and we've made lots of memories over these past 14 days. And as much fun as it is to travel, it's always good to be home. Traveling this far just goes to prove that old saying that there's no place like home. Now, what do you say? Let's get to work on another trip.